Let's continue our journey into the microscopic. We've seen how we can relate the macroscopic polarization, how this should be related to the microscopic nature of our particles within the plasma. And let's try to get the physical connection between the properties of the plasma with the dielectric tensor epsilon. And what is the quantity that fully characterizes our gas? Remember, we did that. And this is the phase space distribution. So we can characterize our gas, in this case a plasma, so an electrically charged gas, in terms of the properties of the probability of finding the probability of finding the particles within this plasma at a certain position and with a certain velocity, right? So we have our particles. We want to know in the phase space how these particles are distributed. Because we have our particles, they have in a certain position, each particle has a certain position and momentums. What we want to know is a collection properties, which is the phase space function, I remind you, that gives you what is the probability of having a certain number of particles at the position x with a certain momentum. I remind you that the momentum P can be associated to the energy of the particles. And this function fully describes the properties of your plasma in a statistical sense, because you don't care for each particle to know where, if it is a position X of P, but you want to know on a certain location in space, X, what is the typical velocity of the particles in that location. Okay? And this density is expressed by F. Again, this is a key concept. We have, for example, position x, y, or z, doesn't matter. And then we have the momentum px or py, if we wish. So this is a six-dimensional space. We've seen that this box here, the function at the position x and p, gives you how many particles you have in this box of your phase space. Okay. And of course, this can evolve as a function of time. Therefore, we can also introduce our time component. Because imagine if we have particles that are, for example, in these locations, okay, at some position, doesn't matter. Momentum P is what? Is positive if this is the zero, right? Therefore, we are above the zero line, means that they have a momentum positive. What does it mean? That in this position x, the particles are moving with a positive component along the y direction. You see, this is characterizing how our plasma is behaving. But that's something that we have already seen. Now, how is the evolution of this function f? How can it be characterized? Well, this is given by the Vlasov equation, or Boltzmann equation. Now I just explain you what they are. Basically give us what is the time evolution of f. How is this function derived? Well, let's approach it in a fully mechanical fashion, in which we have our phase space that is given by some generalized component. So if we are using Cartesian coordinate, it would be x. If we are using some generalized components, for example, just to make our treatment of this mechanical process simpler, we just call it q. Then we have our momentum P. Again, this is, you see, this is the six-dimensional integral of the phase space. P, Q, and then T. Since we are integrating over the entire space, this expresses the probability for a particle of being somewhere, but if I'm integrated over the entire domain of this function, this must be equal to 1. Because if I'm asking myself, you are the particles, the room is a volume, this is the entire domain of the phase space, and I'm asking, what is the probability of finding you in this room when I integrate over the full space of the room? 1. Because you are all there. If I'm restricting the volume and I'm asking what is the probability of finding a student here, is a certain amount. That's not going to be equal to 1. If I move around, then this box, okay, is going to give us what is the probability of finding one of you in one of the seats. But if I'm integrating over the entire space, is 1, because I'm sure that you are there, okay? Therefore, this guy, what's the meaning of this, is that basically that this guy must be conserved. Means that the time evolution of t over the t plus the gradient with respect to the components B of our six-dimensional space of the current F P dot, you see this is P dot, so that's the current of the momentum, plus now the gradient of the other variable, which is Q, for our function, now is the current with respect to the variable Q, Q dot, this must be equal to 0. You see, this is the total derivative of the function F must be equal to 0. F must be conserved. Okay? If you want to see an analogy, you can think of the matter conservation analogy. And we have that the density, rho, is a function of what? Is a function of position and time, Q and T. Remember the Q is the generalized coordinate. So you can, in Cartesian coordinate, you can think of this guy at X. If we integrate over the entire domain of position, this is equal to what? The total matter, M, which is a constant. Now, this is matter conservation. This is the conservation of probability. You see the analogy? Now, what is expressing matter conservation? The continuity equation. How does the continuity equation look like? We have the rho over the t plus the gradient of the current. You see the analogy? It's the very same thing. So this equation expresses the fact that probability integrated over the entire space must be equal to 1. And physically, it means that if particles from this portion of the phase space are moving in this guy, the fact that this cell is gaining probability must be compensated by the fact that this cell is losing probability. And the sum of the two must be the same as before. Okay? So the probability doesn't get destroyed or created in the same fashion of matter. Good. Now, what we can do, we know that we can have a relationship between the momentum and the Hamilton's equations because we are dealing with mechanical systems. Therefore, we can use Hamilton's equations to have to relate the time variation of the position, Q dot, with the derivative of the Hamiltonian that is describing our systems with respect to the momentum, as well as the variation of the momentum P, which is given by the minus the derivative of the Hamiltonian over the generalized coordinate Q. mechanics, simple mechanics. Now you see, look, what do we have? We have this guy, which is just expressing conservation of probability. We have P dot and Q dot that now can be related to the physics of our system that is given by our Hamiltonian. Therefore, we can get our P dot and Q dot and plug them into here. Okay? At the end, what we get is basically, then what we can do is to relate the, we specify the Hamiltonian for our system, right? We just have our particles, which we have that we have the kinetic term, 2m, plus the kinetic, the potential energy, right? We have our Hamiltonian, we plug it into here, and into here, and we get an explicit expression for our system for which give us our beloved Boltzmann equation. The F over the T plus P over M, the F over the X, so I'm just expressing the gradient with respect to the X direction, now I'm going Cartesian, you see, the F over the X, that's this guy here, minus the phi over the X, so that's the other gradient, of the F over the P equal to zero. Conservation of probability, Hamiltonian's equation that allow us to express Q dot and P dot in terms of the Hamiltonian, which is the which incorporates the physics describing the particles. And this is the so-called collisionless Boltzmann equation. That gives you the time evolution of the phase space distribution. Why collisionless? Because the source term is equal to zero. If we want to introduce collisions, we need to include here a collision term that can look in some fashion, or we can express it just in this way if we want to include it. Okay? Then it would be the collisional Boltzmann equation. The Boltzmann equation gives us how the electric field is evolving. Sorry, the electric field. So how the phase space is evolving as a function of time. Now that we have our Boltzmann equation, what we can notice? Well, what we can do is to make a decomposition. We want to decompose F as what? As the background, so the plasma as it is, plus a tiny perturbation, the F. And I remind you that the zero, F0 is the phase space distribution acquired by the particles given the gas as, sorry, the plasma as unperturbed. Imagine, for example, a spherical isothermal sphere that you studied, composed by a plasma, it gets some shape, right? They have thermal dispersion and so on, velocity dispersion for the particles, and this unperturbed plasma is described by a certain phase space distribution, which is constant. The spherical isothermal sphere stays like that, because it's in equilibrium. Then, what we do is that we have an incoming electromagnetic wave, which is, of course, a tiny perturbation. If you think at a spherical isothermal sphere, a gas distribution, which is self-gravitating, a gigantic object, if there is an electromagnetic wave, it's not that it's going to change shape or God knows what, okay? Therefore, we can use a perturbative approach and just consider the effect of the incoming electromagnetic wave described by this tiny perturbation, okay? Okay, I remind you that the F is way smaller with respect to F0, it's a tiny perturbation. So what we care about is not to look for the spherical isothermosphere. You can solve it and see how a self-gravitating system of a gas is behaving. What we care about is only this component, okay, the perturbation. Therefore, if we plug the F in our Boltzmann equation, here, here, and here, we can express, basically derive an explicit case. Well, look, the momentum divided m is what? The velocity, that's b. The gradient of the potential is what? The force. The gradient of the potential is the force expressed by this potential. And what is the force we are talking about? What is the perturbation? The incoming electromagnetic wave. Therefore, what is the force? Is the Lorentz force that the incoming electromagnetic wave is exerting on the particles. Therefore, our equation, our Boltzmann equation, looks like d of our tiny perturbation, the f, as a function of t. I remind you again that this delta is not derivative, just stands for small, plus v. And then we have the gradient of the perturbation, the f, and then we have the Lorentz force the f zero, because we are keeping only the leading term with respect to p equal to zero. And here I kept only the terms at first order. But you see, there is an F0 here, and here we have the perturbation, because all the higher order terms are dropped. But now, what we can notice? We can notice that this is the gradient with respect to the momentum, but the momentum has the direction of the velocities. Therefore, we have something which is orthogonal to the velocity, because it's the vector velocity cross momentum. So this is orthogonal, a vector orthogonal both to the, magnetic field and the velocity, and something which is going along the direction of the velocities. Therefore, the product, the scalar product between this vector and this vector is equal to zero. And our Boltzmann equation, in the end, only for the perturbative component, will look like d of the f over the t plus v gradient of the f equal to e, yes, mean minus goes on the other side, e electric field, the f0 over the p. Last step, we have these derivatives, but we learned that whenever we have this sort of differential equation, it's very convenient to go in the Fourier space and decompose our perturbation in terms of plane waves. And you understand also why we decompose in plane waves, because we are dealing with a perturbation that is given by an electromagnetic wave. And we know that time derivatives in the Fourier space are expressed by minus I omega times the function, the Fourier transform of the function that we are making the time derivative, plus v, and then the gradient of the function in the Fourier space is I k, and then the Fourier transform of our function. On the other side, the same is happening, but that's with respect to the p, and we leave it as it is. So that's equal to e the f0 over the p. And we get our solution. That's as simple as that. For our the f is equal to e over I k x minus omega the f0 over the p. And this is an amazing result. Because everything depends on that. You see, we know the phase space distribution of the particles for our unperturbed plasma. And we know what is going to be the perturbation F given the properties of our incoming electromagnetic wave. We make the link. We are now connecting the macroscopic properties of the plasma and the effect that this has on the incoming electromagnetic wave on the phase distribution, therefore on the very microscopic nature of our plasma. And now we arrived there, it was very simple, because we just had to make few considerations. We just basically used the collisional Boltzmann equation, which is expressing the conservation of the probability, and where we introduced, once we introduced the connection with mechanics through the Hamilton's equation. We used then a perturbative approach. We tracked only the perturbation, which know to be given by an incoming electromagnetic wave, and therefore the force that is applied by this incoming electromagnetic wave on the particles is given by the Lorentz force. We moved into the Fourier space to have a convenient way to solve this equation and find out what is our variation, our perturbation in the phase space distribution F, this little df. And we see that it's connected to the derivative of the unperturbed distribution of the particles in the phase space with respect to the momentum. Therefore, if we know, if we have, for example, our spherical isothermal sphere, or we have a thermal gas where F is expressed by the Maxwell's distribution, we know what the perturbation, the F, is. Now that we have this microscopic expression, we link it back to our polarization, and through the polarization to the epsilon. In doing that, for simplicity, we are going to consider a medium which is homogeneous. Is isotropic and is stationary. In this case, we can then easily represent the density, the charge density associated to the polarization, as well as the current associated to the polarization, in terms of momentums of the phase space function, of the phase space distribution. We have that rho pol is equal to minus E integral of the cube P over the F with respect to position X, momentum P, and times T. So rho pol is a function of time, of position, and time. You see I'm integrating over the momentum, therefore the variables that are left are the position x and the time t. Why is this connection? I mean, it's quite clear, because this is the density of particle in the phase space. We are integrating over the volume with respect to the momentum. We multiply by the charge of our electrons, which are the ones that are relevant, and we get the density, right? Density, so number of particles times their charge is a density, okay? Same goes for the current, J pole, again for position x at time t, is equal to what? It's a charge current, therefore we need to introduce the charge of our particles, the cube p, the f of x p t, times the velocity. You see, this is a density times velocity, this is the current. And now we can link these two guys to find out what is our polarization. How we do that? Well, we just know what is the connection between the polarization density and the polarization current. Because we have their definition, I mean, how we constructed it before. We know that rho pole is equal to the gradient of the polarization P. This is how we constructed the polarization. Through continuity equation, as we have seen, J polarization, the current associated to polarization, is equal to the time derivative of the polarization with respect to time. We can express this guy in Fourier space, where the gradient is expressed as a ik. Therefore, we have the Fourier transform of the polarization, which is what we need, because there we were working in the Fourier space. So we also, as well, here into Fourier space. It's equal to minus, because there is the minus from before, ik that express the gradient, times the Fourier transform of the polarization. The same goes here. We have that the Fourier transform of the polarization is equal to time derivative, therefore minus I omega. You see that there is also the minus that is popping up. This minus I omega stands for the time derivative in the Fourier space. P at. And now we connect this knowledge about the rho and j with this expression of rho and j with respect of momentums of the phase space distribution. For now, I bring this j and I plug it into here. Therefore, we have that this is equal to minus e integral of the entire momentum space of our perturbation, the f, times the velocity v. We can now identify our momentum, our polarization p. And its association to the perturbation or in the phase space, for which we have the solution. Let's use component J. A P was already polarization, so E, and time to create a scalar product, we need G here, over omega, integral, cube p v e over k v minus omega, and then our df0, df over dpj. See? We have our J polarization. This is how it was coming out from continuity equation. We have the relation of J is equal to all of that. And we have our relationship with respect to the perturbation, to the small deviation in the phase space. We plug in here our solution, that we have from before by solving the Boltzmann equation, and we find out what is the relationship between the polarization and the derivative of the phase space, of the unperturbed phase space. So mind that there is a zero, that's super important. And give us our link to our microscopic nature of the plasma. Now that we have P, we can find out what is the dielectric, the displacement, field, D, which I remind you that D is connected to epsilon. So the component E, so I'm working in the Fourier space as we did before. As we have seen, delta Ej is equal to 4 pi PE minus EE. So that was coming out from a Gauss equation. You remember in the Gauss equation, we derived a quantity like that, and we define it as D. And you see that we have the link between D and P. So what we get is 4 pi PE, so I'm just reshuffling this equation, I'm not doing anything special here. I'm just isolating the polarization P. I'm using how we constructed D as well, because we know that it's relating to linear theory. For the component, that's E, E, and E, what is the components E? The E is equal to epsilon E in Fourier space, and then E in Fourier space. Ej need Ej. No, this can't be. All right, J is a tensor, and then J. Okay, this works. Right, we have the dummy variables that is summing up here. We have the component E for the E component of the displacement vector. So we just plug this construction into here. And what we get is epsilon IJ minus delta IJ AJ. Okay, so what I did is to plug into here. You see that we have EJ, EJ, and I can just introduce the delta Kronecker such that I can extract the electric field component outside the parentheses. And we are basically done, because now we have the connection between the dielectric tensor EIJ with the polarization. Fourier transforms, of course. Delta IJ minus 4 pi e squared over epsilon integral over the momentum components VE KV minus omega the F0 over the P. E and then it must be an E. Okay, so what we did there, we studied the macroscopic nature of our plasma that we characterized through the phase space distribution, and the Boltzmann equation is telling us how the phase space is evolving. We use the perturbative approach only to consider the perturbation that we care about, which is the perturbation given by the incoming electromagnetic wave, for which we got this solution, so we know the perturbation of the phase space. Then we made the connection between the phase space that allow us to express the polarization, the charge density and the charge current of the polarization component in terms of momentums of the phase space function. We know what the physics of rho and j, how they are related to the polarization. We just join this equation to find out what is our relationship here once we go to the Fourier space. We express, we plug in our solution that we found out by solving the Boltzmann equation, and we get our dielectric tensor in the end after we made the connection with the definition of the displacement vector D, which we know to be expressed in terms of the dielectric tensor epsilon ij. And this gives us a direct connection between the dielectric epsilon, the dielectric tensor, and therefore all the properties that the plasma is having to affect incoming electromagnetic waves, and the unperturbed solution of the that give us the phase space distribution of the plasma. Therefore, if you know how a plasma is distributed, you can as well find out what is the dielectric tensor, and therefore how all the properties of the electromagnetic waves are occurring in your plasma. Okay? Then, last thing, we can now go back and look at this dielectric tensor in the decomposition, in its term, I rewrite it here, in its term, epsilon, as we are in the Fourier space, components ij, as expressed in terms of its component orthogonal to the direction of incoming electromagnetic wave, and the parallel component of epsilon with respect to the direction of the incoming electromagnetic wave, but along its direction of propagation. If we now apply our projectors to this equation, we basically find out what is epsilon for the two components. Can I skip it? Okay, so we have our epsilon for the parallel component, which is, that's Fourier transforms, of course. 1 minus, because that's the ij component, because that's the isotropic part, 4 pi epsilon square over k square. Then we have the integral of over the momentum space, k, the f0 over the p. And then we have our 1 over kv minus omega. Then we have the other component, epsilon orthogonal, which is equal to 1 minus 2 pi e square over omega, now should be, yes, integral over the cube P, and then we have V orthogonal over the F0 over the P. And we have the same factor here as well. Okay, so the steps are trivial. You find them in the script. But what I basically did was to apply the projectors to our dielectric tensor. And this allows us to find out what is the dispersion relation. Because in the end we know that we get trivial, non-trivial solutions whenever the determinant of 1 minus omega square epsilon for the transform c square k squared of the component ij minus omega square over c square k epsilon p ortogonal I, parallel ij equal to 0. And this is super important. Why is that? Look, we have waves that are propagating. So you see, we have two dispersion relations. Wait, there is a, that's the projector, so this must be here. So we have a dispersion relation for waves orthogonal to the direction of the incoming of propagation of the incoming electromagnetic waves, and a components which is going along the direction of propagation of the incoming electromagnetic waves. That's something new. That's something that we hadn't in the vacuum, because now we also have longitudinal waves. We have the electric field that is kind of oscillating along the direction of the incoming electromagnetic wave, but we have a component of the electric field which is also oscillating along the direction of propagation of our incoming electromagnetic wave. Longitudinal waves, that's something new. Okay? That was not present in the vacuum. And the other thing that we can notice is that the transverse component, so let me stress it for the very key important, and I will write it in yellow, we have longitudinal waves. And if we look at the dispersion relation, if we look also for the for this wave, we see that they are propagating with a different velocity with respect to what's happening in vacuum. So if we look for the orthogonal component, we have that omega squared is equal to c squared k squared over the dielectric tensor, the orthogonal component. See, for the transverse one, I'm using this equation, but this has to be equal to zero, that gives us our dispersion relation. We have this expression. You see, I just isolated omega. And look, now the velocity is not anymore c squared of these waves, it is actually c, I mean the square of the velocity is not c square, but is c square over epsilon. Therefore, the incoming electromagnetic waves are going to have a velocity which is different with respect to the one in vacuum. Okay? So we can stop here and just make a super fast recap of these two boards. The one on top I will not recap because I already did it before. So we arrived through the fact that the probability must be conserved for the phase space distribution. We use the mechanics to relate the evolution, the time evolution of the phase space distribution of our particle in time, so we know they evolve as a function of time, through the Boltzmann equation. By solving the Boltzmann equation, we find out, using a perturbative approach, we find out what is the solution. We know what is going to be our perturbation given the F0, which is the phase space distribution of our unperturbed plasma. Then we just use the definition for the polarization and how it is its relation to the current that can be expressed now in terms of momentum of the phase space distribution that gave us basically this expression. Now we have the relation between the polarization that expresses the ensemble properties of the electric dipoles in a certain volume with the properties of the unperturbed plasma. F0, the phase space distribution of the unperturbed plasma. Then we just use the definition of the displacement potential. We use the its relationship to the electric field through the dielectric tensor to isolate the dielectric tensor and find out how the dielectric tensor is expressed in terms of the phase space distribution of the particles. So if you know how a plasma is distributed in space, how it is evolving as a function of time and all of that, you know what is going to be the electric component. Then by studying this dielectric tensor, by making the composition along its component, along the propagation of the incoming electromagnetic wave and orthogonal to it, we basically find out the two dispersions relations that are given by this expression that give us the condition for having a non-trivial solution. You get the velocity dispersion for waves orthogonal and longitudinal, and you discover that, oh, there are longitudinal waves. That's something new. That's something that was not present in vacuum. So we have longitudinal waves that can propagate in a plasma. Okay? The electric and the magnetic field are not orthogonal to the direction of propagation of the waves, but are along the direction. And if we look at the dispersion relation for the component of the transverse waves, we see that actually the velocities are propagating with a velocity which is not c. The velocity of these waves are affected by the dielectric tensor. These are the two big results that we have now, and we have the relationship between the nature, the intrinsic nature, and the characteristic of our plasma. So we can work now with plasmas. Okay? Next lecture, I'm going to give you a simple application in which we just see very briefly how we can apply this expression with a real phase space distribution for a thermal plasma. I'm going to use the case of thermal plasma, which velocity distribution is given by the Maxwell phase space distribution. Okay? So we will see also the connection between the properties of the plasma and the Debye length and the plasma frequency. And we are going to see the key role of these parameters characterizing the plasma in the propagation of the electromagnetic waves. Okay, thank you very much, and see you next time.